Welcome to this God-inspired message from Shofar Christian Church. Enjoy today's message. May you experience the presence of our Father, and may you grow deeper in your relationship with Him.
Sure, we had such an amazing time at the camp last weekend. Who can agree? Was it good? Oh, hallelujah. Thanks for everybody that was able to join. If you missed out this year, don't worry. We'll have another one. Thanks so much for everybody that made an effort. It was there and it was so good. It's good to just spend time. I'm still a little bit stiff. Don't laugh. Some of the young men talked me into playing touch rugby. Anyways, I didn't end up at the physio, which is a miracle, but I did feel it. Hey guys, what a blessing. Let me just find my notes here. So we had a great parenting moment this morning. I left David at home. All the parents, yeah, hallelujah. So yeah, there you go. Darren, I went to fetch him. But I'm quite impressed with him because he remained calm. And he found Erna's laptop and then he WhatsApped me from a laptop. Yeah, yeah, it's like, not too shabby. Because obviously he doesn't really have a device that can communicate with other people. But yeah, so we managed to find him and bring him. In any case, at least he's old enough to probably, would have been fine and probably would have enjoyed himself at home on his own, I think, in any case. Hallelujah. So, just a privilege to share the word this morning. And just want to thank everybody that shared words. It just encourages me when God kind of confirms what He wants to do. And Diego also just mentioned now that the Lord's saying, consecrate yourselves to the Lord. And then he says, because I'm the one that sanctifies you. Let's start actually with the scripture we've been looking at for a couple of times, since the beginning of the year. But let's just pray for the word. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, for your word this morning. And we thank you, God, that your word is not a dead document, Lord, but it's alive. And Jesus, the word made flesh, who came and lived among us, Lord. And we just thank you, Holy Spirit, this morning that you're our teacher. And that you come and breathe life over every single one of us, Lord. Young and old, you breathe life over us. And we thank you that you lead us into your truth. We're not here for any man's opinion, Lord, but we're here to meet with you, Lord. And our expectation is, Lord, that you would transform us and make us more into the image of your Son, in Jesus' name. For your glory, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. So Psalm 24, just one or two verses there you read last week also. Who may climb the mountain of the Lord and who may stand in his holy place? Only those whose hands and hearts are pure, who do not worship idols and never tell lies. They will receive the Lord's blessing and have a right relationship with God, their Savior. Such people may seek you and worship in your presence, O God of Jacob. And now we've looked at this a couple of times, and I just want us to remember and remind ourselves that, you know, when we read this, we feel, oh, okay, well then, I'm not included in this picture because I do not qualify. But just to remind ourselves that the reason why Jesus came is exactly this, that he might make us holy, and he might cleanse us. And He is the one that gives us clean hands and pure hearts. And He is the one that paid the price so that we are able indeed to ascend the hill of the Lord. Amen. And like Phil mentioned a week or two ago, that when we asked this question, who may stand in this holy place? That yes, I may, because of the blood of Jesus, because that I am in Christ. I'm no longer on my own. I'm no longer standing on my own performance or my own works, but I'm in Christ. So therefore, yes, I am included, and I am able to ascend, and I am able to stand in His holy place. Hallelujah. What a blessing. And just encourage me what Birgit shared now, because it says that He is the one that sanctifies us. We are not able to do that ourselves. But He does ask us to consecrate ourselves to Him. And we're going to just look at that a little bit this morning. I'm going to read from Romans chapter 6 quite a bit, so just hang in there. Well then, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of His wonderful grace? Of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Or how... Or have you forgotten that when we were joined with Christ, Christ Jesus in baptism, we joined in Him in His death? So we were in the baptism, we died with Christ. For we died and were buried with Christ by baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives. Since we have been united with Him in His death, we will also be raised to life as He was. We know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. Isn't that good news? We are no longer slaves to sin, for when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know we will also live with Him. We are sure of this because Christ was raised from the dead, and He will never die again. Death no longer has any power over Him. When He died once to break the power of sin. But now that He lives for the glory of God. So you also should consider yourselves to be dead to the power of sin and alive to God through Christ Jesus. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, give yourselves completely to God. For you were dead, but now you have new life. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Sin is no longer your master. For you no longer live under the requirements of the law. Instead, you live under the freedom of God's grace. Here's the gospel summarized in a couple of verses. So let's just focus here. Just repeat in verse 13. Instead, give yourselves completely to God. For you were dead, but now you have new life. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Hallelujah. So I want to read a definition. I don't have it on the screen here. A couple of definitions of consecrate or consecrated. So it's to make or declare something sacred. And then specifically in these dictionaries that talk about for a religious purpose. But then in an informal setting is to devote something exclusively to a particular purpose. Okay, now a couple of years ago, before, you know, there's another BC, before children, right? So before children, and I sometimes had the time to make sushi. Huh? Yes, that's amazing. We still have that stuff somewhere in our house, but at one point it was quite fun, you know. We liked eating sushi, and then somebody gave us the set as a gift to make sushi, and then we even did the whole rice thing as well, which is the longest and most complicated part of making sushi. And then we realized you can actually buy the rice from a place, you know, already made. Saves you like a whole day. Any case, but anyway, long story short is in that set, there's a very special knife. It's made for sushi. And it's amazing. It's extremely sharp and it's not very strong. It's very thin. So I don't think it'll be good for much else than making sushi. So that's all it's used for. We never use that knife for anything else. It's in the that set, that box that we have with all our sushi stuff. It's in there. And I must confess we haven't used it in a long time. But that is typically what consecrate means. It's when something has been devoted for a specific use and it's not used for anything else. Okay? Have you got stuff like that in your house? Yes, maybe. Sometimes it's that special tool that you only use when it's something very special. Or, I don't know, what are good examples where, you know, that comes out only at a specific time or for a specific purpose, and then, and be, you know, the Lord be with anybody that uses that thing for something that it's not supposed to do. Amen? You know what I'm talking about. So, or for instance, that maybe in a completely different context, that bottle of wine that your dad was keeping for so long for that specific occasion, right? And then that occasion comes and then it's so special because you just hope that it's still special because sometimes it apparently turns into vinegar. But anyways, and isn't that a powerful picture of us? You know, when the Lord says, consecrate yourselves, of us being set aside for a very specific purpose. And that is for the glory of God. And give yourselves completely to God. Use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. That's such a powerful concept. And yet, isn't that such a difficult thing to live out? It's not as simple as that, is it? And I just want us to look at a couple of bits of scripture and really just allow the Holy Spirit to encourage us and inspire us that this is what we have been called for. We have been called to, yes, to stand in His holy place, to enter His presence, and He's the one that sanctifies us to be able to go there, right? But there is a very powerful role that we have to play to say, I choose to consecrate myself. I choose to set, as we chose to set that knife and that stuff in that set apart for only that thing. And that's why when we need it, it's there, right? We can use it. In the same way that we did it, in a similar way, we can choose to say, Lord, I choose to set myself apart. Choose to, and we're going to look at a couple of different ways how we can do that. All right, let's look at Daniel. So we see this in the life of Daniel. So I don't want to read the whole bit, but I'm just going to read bits of the life of Daniel just to illustrate how he lived the consecrated life. So Daniel chapter 1, I'm going to pick one or two verses between 8 and 15. So what happened here is the nation were taken away into bondage, right? So they were slaves to this Nebuchadnezzar. They were taken enslaved. They were no longer able to choose their own destiny. I'm sure these guys were all Daniel and his friends. They were all very clever and ambitious young men, and now everything's changed, right? So now they are in bondage, they are in another nation, they are now enslaved to another king, and they have to do whatever he wants, right? So, and they, a few of them were set aside, the brightest and the cleverest and the best were set aside to serve the king specifically, and they were given very amazing food and everything else that the king would also eat. But then they realized that this was not going to be good for them. So this is on a physical level, right? So verse 8 says, but Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Now, I suppose in this way, you can see that almost defiling as the opposite of consecration. So, if something is not, if it's supposed to be set apart for something else, if somebody would take out that knife and then use it as a screwdriver, that would be painful, right? So that would, Daniel saw this would, in a physical sense, not would be consecrated to God anymore. So they said, no, he's resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or the wine that he drank. Therefore, he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. And God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And then Daniel said to the steward, whom the chief of the eunuchs had assigned over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat, water to drink. Let our appearance and appearance of the youths who eat the king's food be observed by you, and deal with your servants according to what you see. So he listened to them in this matter, and he tested them for 10 days, and at the end of the 10 days, it was seen that they were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youths who ate the king's food. And the illustration here is that Daniel's consecration started on a physical level. Right? So our consecration to God is in a physical level, body, soul, in a soul level, but also in a spiritual level. And often, and maybe this is just, I don't know, the way I think about things, but because God has made us three parts, body, soul, and spirit, whenever something happens or whenever I realize God is dealing with me about something, excuse me, I always trust God, okay, Lord, how can I grow in this or how can I change or be transformed on all three, in all three parts of me, body, soul, and spirit? Or when I'm struggling with something or I'm wrestling with a challenge, then I'm asking the Holy Spirit, how can I address this body, soul, and spirit? Are you with me? So I want to encourage you to do the same. If you're wrestling with depression or if you're wrestling with something else or an addiction or something, don't just address one. Go and trust the Holy Spirit for body, soul, and spirit. Lord, how can I be healthy in my body? How can I be healthy in my mind? How can I be healthy in my spirit? Amen? So address those three things, body, soul, and spirit. Thanks so much, brother. What a blessing. Is it coffee? Oh, no, it's water. Next time. Thanks. So his consecration to God starts in a very physical sense. It says, okay, look, those years they had very strict rules about what they could eat and what they couldn't eat and as the Jews. So even though those are not applicable to us, the concept of our body being a temple of the Holy Spirit, that's huge. Okay, the whole picture of a temple is a space where that is holy and set apart and consecrated so that the presence of God may dwell in us and with us. Amen? So what does it look like? How do we keep our bodies consecrated to God? I believe there's some stuff that we need to abstain from because, you know, the scripture says everything is permissible in moderation, but not everything is beneficial, right? So yes, there's stuff that the world is getting up to and the stuff that the world is indulging into that is not good for us, not only on a health level, but in a spiritual level in terms of what we do with our bodies, right? So that concept of us being a temple of the Holy Spirit, that's why we fast, that's why when we realize I've got some kind of addiction or dependency on something like coffee, you know, then I can deal with it. I can say, okay, this isn't healthy. This isn't good. This is not bringing glory to God. I can bring this before God. I can deal with it. I can process it. And I can consecrate my body to God. Amen? In the same way, I was so convicted the other day, just in terms of physical health and exercise. Because you always think, oh, it's like a good extra. You know, it's like when you get around to it type of thing. But I'm at the age now where I have to really make an effort. And it's so crucial for us to be physically healthy in our bodies, all right? So the consecration starts in our bodies, the physical sense. And maybe while we're at the physical bit, also our physical space. And I remember when we were at varsity, I really started to kind of be discipled when I joined Shofar. I was born again a couple of years before that, but there was a time where everybody was kind of aware of the stuff that we have in our space that does not honor God. Stuff that was from before, the other BC, you know, before Christ. And where you realize, oh dear, there's things that I've, physical things that I've brought with me from my life before I knew Jesus, that physical things that do not glorify God. Okay? So I remember some guys, okay, some of the young people, you don't know what tapes are. Anyways, let's not get distracted into that. But some guys that found like old dodgy music and stuff that's like not glorifying God, and they would throw that stuff away or burn it or something, or obviously anything, yeah, it was not glorifying God. But even stuff like that were consecrated to something else, maybe a little, you know, those little cats you see in the Chinese shops. The little, have you seen them? Just ask them why is that cat there? But so something like that, the cat has got a spiritual purpose there. So if somebody ever gave you a cat like that and it's sitting on your shelf, please do yourself a favor. Okay, that's a silly example, but get rid of stuff like that. I remember one time I wasn't on that team, but a friend of mine was leading the team, coming back from a mission trip. I think it was Malawi or something. And on the way home, they bought a bunch of curios at a curio shop next to the road, just little carvings and things to bless their prayer partners. And it was absolutely supernatural. They bought some the stuff, they got on the bus, and half the team was sick within a couple of kilometers, physically ill. And they're like, oh my goodness, this is not good. And they thought and prayed, and then they realized, and they made the connection, and then I don't know how they discerned which was good and which wasn't. I think they just chucked everything on a pile and burnt it, and everybody was fine immediately. All right, so sometimes stuff is literally cursed, sometimes stuff is literally consecrated to something that's demonic, right? It's not worshiping, not honoring God, not glorifying God. So trust the Holy Spirit for discernment. Go through your physical space. Say, Lord, what is there in my physical space that doesn't honor you? Maybe it's a book that somebody gave you years ago that you didn't even read it, but it, you know it's dodgy. Just get rid of it. Please don't give it to somebody else. Okay? Are you with me? So even in our physical space, we can consecrate our space to God. And maybe at your office, maybe it's time again for you to go early to your office and consecrate the space. Say, take some oil. Say, Lord, I consecrate this space to you. You can't throw stuff away at the office necessarily, maybe, unless it's your own office. But go and, you know, take oil, anoint the place, consecrate the space. Okay, then let's go on. I don't know if I missed the next part of Daniel. Let me just see. Oh dear. Yep, it didn't make it. Sorry. Let me just read it to you. Daniel 6. So this is the part where the guys got jealous of Daniel because he was being promoted. He was doing well. He was extremely talented. The Bible says he had an excellent spirit in him. Doesn't that challenge you on some level? That this guy was so impressive that everybody wanted to get rid of him, right? But it says he had an excellent spirit in him. Hallelujah. I believe God wants to give each of us an excellent spirit. Now, it doesn't matter if you're studying or practicing law, whatever you're doing, God has got an excellent spirit that he wants to put in us to glorify him in what we're doing. Amen? And so they wanted to get rid of him, so they convinced the king to make this new law that only the king could be worshipped and prayed to, nobody else. So this whole law was passed aimed exactly at Daniel, all right? That was their purpose, to get rid of this guy. And let's read here Daniel 6. If you have a Bible, you're welcome to turn there. Daniel 6. All right. Let's read from verse 5. Then these men said, "We shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God." So they realized there's nothing against this guy, so they have to make a clever plan. And let's go on to verse 10. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber open toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had done previously. I don't have to tell you the rest of the story, but they caught him in the act praying, and then they obviously was put in the lion's den, and the Lord delivered him supernaturally. But the reason I'm reading this is because he had this habit of consecration, of consecrating himself to the Lord 3 times a day, coming before the Lord in prayer, setting time aside. And can you see that this is not something that he thought up on the day? This was a lifestyle. And when things got really tough, and things, then the law was passed, he didn't go underground. He didn't go and hide. He said, "Lord, I will do this in the way that I was convicted to do." And he continued in his consecration. He continued in his habit and his discipline. So there's the soul and the spirit there in terms of our consecration in our thoughts and our mind. Romans speaks about us not being conformed to this world, but being transformed by the renewing of our mind. And again, a powerful picture that if our thoughts and the way we think and the way our soul operates is the same as the world, that's not pleasing to God. And there's a very deliberate act of us saying, I'm not going to be conformed, I'm going to be transformed. My mind needs to be renewed. And I've honestly noticed that this is not something that happens all at once. Okay? I'm actually quite thankful to God that it doesn't happen all at once. But that the Holy Spirit shows us step by step. And he would highlight something. He would say, this stuff that you are thinking about, or this stuff that's going on in your thoughts, or this that you busy with, and suddenly it would convict us of something that we weren't convicted of before. Amen? And that means now is the time to sort that out. Hallelujah. So how do we keep our minds consecrated to God? The Word gives us an incredible, beautiful picture. It speaks of the washing by the Word. And this is the good side of brainwashing. Amen. Where the Word of God washes us, washes our thoughts, cleanses us, and as we immerse ourselves in the Scripture, we are the way we think and the way we believe is transformed to become godly and pleasing to God. Isn't that amazing? The way we believe, the way we think, which in turn directs what we say and what we do, starts right here in our thoughts. We need to keep ourselves consecrated to God. Amen. And then on a spiritual level, as Daniel did, in prayer, in thanksgiving, and also in the Word, shaping our beliefs, shaping the way we believe about something. And I want to really challenge you about this. This is what's great about Bible school, it's great about small group, is when we get together, right? It's nice to serve God on an island. There's nobody that challenges your beliefs or your thoughts or your actions, right? That's different. But when we come into a community like this and we put ourselves in a space where there are other believers around us and we make ourselves vulnerable and open ourselves up to input from other people, hallelujah, that's where the real growth happens, amen? Where iron starts sharpening iron and you say something and I disagree and I say something and you disagree and we can go to the scripture and we can look at the scripture and we can say, oh dear, we both got it wrong, you know? Hallelujah. But that's so healthy because it creates a space where I realize, wow, God is busy with something in my heart. He's busy. He's forming Christ in me. But for that to happen, I need to have this attitude of saying my life and my thoughts and my soul, my spirit are set apart for God for a specific purpose. If I don't have that attitude of consecration, I'm probably not going to care much. Amen. Probably going to say, oh, yeah, it'll be cool one day to read more scripture when I have time. Or, you know, I know I have a bit of a conviction about this, but if I ignore this unction of the Holy Spirit enough, it'll probably go away. You know, all right. So, but this attitude of saying, today, Lord, may my life be an instrument of worship to you. May my body, soul, and spirit glorify your name. May I walk in the fullness of the purpose that you have set me apart for. The purpose for which Christ came and died for in my life. Amen. And I find this, for me, if I can have a time of a quiet space and a few moments with God in the morning, it just changes the trajectory of my day. Having a time where I'm not only a time of consecration and just bringing my thoughts, and sometimes it's short, right, to be honest. No, I'm not talking about necessarily just studying the scripture, but having a time where you say, Lord, today I consecrate myself to you, my body, my soul, and my spirit, as slaves to righteousness. Amen. In other words, set apart for what you want to do today. Just puts us on that trajectory to see his kingdom coming in our lives. Amen. All right. Let's stand this morning. I just have a couple of things I felt we need to pray about. Yeah, so you might be finding yourself in a season that you can't really figure it out. What is God doing? You know, what's happening? And I want to just encourage us. If you look at the scripture, we see guys like Moses starting with incredible intervention of God in his life and then growing up with the best of the best in a royal environment, okay? The best education, the best of everything. And then, I mean, this guy was set for life, and then stuff just goes pear-shaped, okay? He ends up a fugitive from the law, on the run, in the wilderness, bad for a long time, okay? But so that must have been a difficult season for him. There was so much that potential, and then there was almost seems like nothing. Or somebody like Joseph also started off like, okay, this guy's going places, and then he ends up a slave, and then he ends up a slave in prison. It's like, I don't think there's a lower point than that, to be a slave and in prison. But guys like even Daniel, like we just spoke, taken captive. Or David, the youngest in the house, sitting in the field, tending the sheep, to such an extent that his father forgets about him. Oh yes, I have another son, okay? Like me this morning, forgetting my son. Anyway, I only have one. Hallelujah. So that's what happens when you come to church in two cars. Anyway, so I don't know. Maybe you're finding yourself in a season where you don't exactly know what God is doing. But what's so powerful about what we see in the scriptures of these very normal men that had lots of faults and lots of issues, but throughout those seasons, they stayed consecrated to God. They kept themselves, even after sinning and even after falling short, coming back to God and repenting and confessing and keeping themselves consecrated, set aside. I mean, to be honest, I don't know if I would have been able to keep a pure heart going through what he went through. But the grace of God was with him. Even in the midst of being falsely accused and imprisoned, and he kept his heart pure before God. And I felt that's for somebody here too this morning, that even in the in-between seasons, even in the seasons where stuff is coming at you or things seem to be not so smooth or things seem to not make sense, to keep your heart, your body, soul, and spirit consecrated to him. Amen. You never know. Maybe it's like David. Maybe you're in the process of preparation. Maybe you're facing the lion and the bear so that Goliath can be put in his place. But the lion and the bear are scary. Okay, they're not to be trifled with. But through the grace of God, he gives us what we need to overcome the lion and the bear in our preparation for what lies ahead, for the giants that he wants you to slay. Amen. I also felt there's some of us here that you started off in your career and your job and you started off consecrated to God, and you were very deliberate, because consecration is not something that happens by accident. It's not something that happens just going with the flow. It's the opposite of going with the flow. So I just sense there's some of us that in the start of our career, we were very aware in our consecration to God, in our workplace. But right now, it's not like that. And I just sense there's an unction of the Spirit for you to turn back and say, Lord, in my career, in my workplace, in my where I spend so much time, how can I bring that back into a consecrated space for you? Amen. For somebody, I feel there's a relationship, even your family, maybe a family or a relationship that you need to bring into consecration to God. For some, there's, you know, it's one of those crazy things one sees from time to time where we trust God and we pray and we fast and we're something that we're praying for so long, and then when it happens and the blessing comes, maybe it's children, maybe it's a spouse, a partner, or something like that, and when that blessing comes, suddenly we start worshiping the blessing instead of the one that gave us the blessing. Suddenly we exalt the blessing above the blessor. And I just feel there's some of us that need to just bring that back into the right order again. Say, Lord, you're these children that you've blessed me with, or this person that you've blessed me with, or this job that you've blessed me with, this also, Lord, I bring it into consecration. Bring it into subjection to your will and your purpose and your glory. And if for some it may mean that you have to confess, Lord, I actually, this thing has become an idol in my life, to bring it back into its place. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's just close our eyes as we pray. Hallelujah. Father, we're so thankful for your presence here this morning. Hallelujah. Lord, you know every heart. You know every person. You know our deepest thoughts and fears, our deepest ambitions and dreams, Lord. You know us better than we know ourselves. Thank you, Lord, that even with this knowledge we can be at peace in your presence, Lord, because we know that you love us exactly the way we are, Lord. And through the blood of Christ, you call us to yourself in our sinful state, in our brokenness. You call us to yourself, and you bring healing, and you bring restoration. Thank you that you love us just as we are, Lord, but you love us enough that you do not leave us the way we are, Father. Thank you that your grace abounds, Lord, so that we are able to grow from glory to glory, that we are able to be transformed into your image, Lord. Yeah, and we thank you that the way that you have made for us is through the blood of Jesus. You have opened the way for us through forgiveness and healing and restoration and deliverance. Oh, every eye is closed. If you here this morning and you do not yet have an assurance of salvation, you do not know for sure that you have a real relationship with God the Father, that you're not absolutely confident that He has died for your sins and that you have inherited eternal life, it will be my privilege to pray with you this morning. If you in your heart, you know that there's something that you need to make right with God this morning, won't you just raise your hand for a moment, and I would love to pray with you this morning. Thanks so much. Amen. We're going to pray for you in just in a moment. And there's a couple of other people I want to pray for. As we're just consecrating ourselves to God, if you want to respond to the word and there's something specific that you want to bring to Him again, maybe it's your work, maybe it's your relationship, maybe it's your marriage or your children or just your life as a whole, say, God, here I am. Don't you want to just step out as a step of faith to say, Lord, here I am. I want to consecrate myself to you again, to your purpose and your glory in my life. Just step out to the front. I'm just going to pray together for a moment. And if you've raised your hand just a moment ago, you can come to the front as well. We're going to pray together. Thanks so much. Can I ask for some facilitators to come and help me pray? We're just going to spend some time praying together. As they're coming to the front, let's just bring our hearts before the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we bring our hearts before you in humility this morning. We thank you for the blood of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that you are the one that sanctifies us. You are the one that opens the way that we are able to stand in your holy place, Lord. That we come now in humility and we ask, Lord, that you would show us in our body, in our soul, in our spirit, in our physical space, how can we live a consecrated life, Lord? How can we daily, moment by moment, set ourselves aside, set ourselves apart for your glory, for your purpose, for your plan, Lord, in the name of Jesus, so that your Holy Spirit can work through us, Lord, so that we can be that vessel of glory, that we can be that vessel of your kingdom coming in every life around us, God, in the name of Jesus. We yield our hearts to you, Lord. We yield our lives to you. You are as vessels of honor, Lord. Vessels, yes, earthen vessels, cracked and broken, Lord, but vessels that consecrated to you, Lord, for your purpose and for your glory, God, in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, I pray you bring conviction of stuff that we must lay down at the cross, stuff that we must repent of, maybe addictions, maybe stuff that we are relying on, maybe things that we are lifting up above you, maybe stuff in our physical space that do not honor you, Lord. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would come and convict and that you give us boldness to act, Lord, to cut off, to root out, Lord, whatever is not pleasing to you, whatever does not bring glory to you, God, in the name of Jesus. And we ask, Lord Jesus, as a congregation, we ask, Lord, let your name be glorified in our midst, Lord. We declare that Shofar Pretoria is set apart for your purposes in this city and in this province and in this nation, Lord. We are set apart for your glory, and for your mandate that you've given us, Lord, for no other purpose, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Even this week, Lord, come and be glorified in and through us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. As we're praying for guys in the front, you're welcome to stay in the presence of God, or you're welcome to have some refreshments with us outside. If you need prayer for anything else, please come to the front. We'd love to pray with you. If you're trusting for something or for healing or whatever it may be, we'd love to pray with you. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this message from Shofar Christian Church. We believe that you enjoyed your time with us, establishing God's kingdom and His glory in your life. For more info, call us on 012-362-1363, email us pretoria@shofaronline.org, browse our website www.shofaronline.org, or like us on facebook.com/shofarpretoria.